Well, good to have you here tonight, and I want you to turn in your Bible to Hebrews chapter number 5 this evening, if you would. Hebrews chapter number 5. I want you to continue to pray, if you would, just for folks in our church that are sick. I don't remember a time where we've had more people that I've even personally been contacted, let alone the staff, where more people have been sick. We got a lot of people out with COVID. Some people have the flu. As I said this morning, some people have both. I guess there's a name for that when you get both. So just pray for them. Luckily, by the grace of God, they say this variant is not as severe as Delta, and so that's a blessing. That doesn't at all negate the fact that people are still battling, and you know, their strength, their energy, their lungs, all of that. Some people have the long ramifications of it. It's just, you know, it's real. And those that say it's not real, well, I don't really have any kind words to say, so I won't say anything at all. My mom taught me that. So just pray for them if you would. The list is too long to name names. Some don't want it to be said anyway, and others might. And so just pray for all of them. How about this? God knows who they are. So keep that in mind. All right? Hebrews chapter number 5, we're going to read a couple verses here and have a word of prayer and get right into the message here tonight. I will not be long this evening. Hebrews chapter 5, and notice if you would, verse number 12. Hebrews chapter 5 and verse 12. The Bible says, Hebrews 5:12. For the time, you ought to be teachers. Now look up here for just a minute. I just want to say this real quick. I won't do this all the way through the passage. The Holy Spirit here, the writer of Hebrews, is saying there's a time where now you've gotten to a stage that now you ought to be teaching somebody else, right? You ought to be teaching somebody else instead of constantly you being taught. At some point, you are going to take what you have learned and you're going to give that out to somebody else. I'll tell you in the brief condensed version, I did a message a couple years ago where over here I had a big thing of water and I had a sponge, and then I had water and a sponge, and I gave an analogy here. And I said, you know, this one over here is a Christian that takes in the word, and I put the sponge in the water, and I pulled it out after it was in the water, and I wrung it out. And that's the Christian that just, they give it, they take it in, you get all the messages. You take it in, you're reading your Bible every day, you're hearing preaching 3 times a week, and you're spending time with God and devotions and what have you, you're growing spiritually, and so now you're going to give out. So you take that and you wring it out. That's the sponge. That's the Christian that gives out what they've got. You know, knowledge puffeth up. Well, this one over here I took and put it in the water, and I set it out and I just let it sit. And everybody knows what a sponge does that just sits. For a while it's okay, right? But after that, what happens? It stinks. And that's just a nice way of saying, you stink. No, I'm just kidding. I would never do that. But you get the point. The point is, there comes a time where you don't just absorb. It's that simple. You give out. Hebrews 5:12, for the time, you ought to be teachers. You should be teaching. But notice the rebuke. You have need that one teach you, here it is, again, which be the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not strong meat. You can't give meat and Bible anymore or strong meat. Notice what it says in verse 13. For everyone that useth milk is unskillful in the word of righteousness, for he is a babe. There's such as a babe in Christ. Verse 14. But strong meat. I'll look up here for one more minute. Strong meat. Strong meat isn't necessarily just we're going to study the tabernacle or Ezekiel's wheel or, you know, some deep little Bible study about, you know, you name it, right? It isn't necessarily that, although it can include that, but sometimes strong meat is, it can seem like it's basic, but to me, strong meat is, here's an example. Let everyone esteem others better than themselves. Now that's strong meat because that's the essence of Christianity. But watch this, verse 14, but strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of us have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Father, I pray you'll bless this Bible study tonight and use it for your glory in Jesus' name and amen. A litmus test is, by definition, is that if you say that something is a litmus test of something, you mean it is in effect a definitive way of proving or measuring something. Now I asked Brother Mason, I said, Mason, what is a litmus test? And what where's Mace? What did you say it was, Mace? Where is he at? A level of pH or a hot tub or a pool. Well, he's actually right. But in this context, we know it's something different, right? You hear about judicial Supreme Court nominees, and you hear about when it comes to the judicial system that we don't have to have a litmus test for those that are going to sit on the bench. Now, a litmus test is an effective way or definitive way of proving or measuring something. So I want to say this tonight, just as a segue into this Bible study. I want you to gauge tonight, am I to the point where I can teach somebody else? Or do I need somebody to teach me again the very first principles and the oracles of God? And I want you to answer the question in the litmus test. Growth. Growth is necessary in all areas of life, business, industry. It's even true with our bodies, especially when we're younger. If our bodies are not growing the way they need to be, we have a problem. Now, I understand there's many people that would like to stop growing. I get that. But it's vital for certain parts of our body to be growing. I'll give you an example. 15 years ago, I was diagnosed with, basically it's called celiac disease, whatever you want to call it. And I had a biopsy done of my small intestine, and all the villi was all laid flat. I had massive malabsorption that was happening in my body. I was losing weight. I got really, this is 15 years ago, I was so skinny, I had to run around in the shower to get wet. I was a rail. I looked anemic. What was happening, I didn't know, and finally the doctor said, you don't look good, let's do this, let's do a bunch of tests, and finally they did that test. So some people say they're gluten-free because they just, for some reason, it's in vogue, and it was actually not even cool until I became gluten-free. Now everybody wants to do it, but having said that, there's some people that can have the option if they want to eat it or not. If I eat gluten, then, you know, Mason, you're preaching, right? It's not happening. It's all over for me. But I was having malabsorption happen in my body. Unfortunately, we have many professing Christians that are dealing with malabsorption. If the nutrients of the word are not permeating the body, it will leave the Christian weak. It's just that simple. It is a known thing. And it's so funny, I could say this a million times, and for some reason, it's kind of like it's not going to change the fact that I'm not all of a sudden going to get in my Bible every day for certain people. It doesn't matter who says it. It's a decision for whatever reason. My response to that is sin will either keep you from the Bible or the Bible will keep you from sin. So growth is vital. I want you to turn your Bible to a couple places tonight. Look at Ephesians 4 and, if you would, Ephesians 4 and 1 Corinthians 3. Just turn there. So growth is vital, especially in our Christian lives. If you remember, Peter said, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the, that you may grow thereby. Spiritual growth must be well-rounded, balanced growth. The Christian must grow in knowledge, in zeal, in faith, in Christ-like character, and in good works. Ephesians chapter 4, look if you would at verse 13. The Bible says, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Look at verse 14. That we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about by every wind of doctrine. Look up here for just 1 minute. Let me say this. Do you know who's carried about by every wind of doctrine? By the sleight of men? Christians that are anemic and Christians that have are not growing spiritually, they're children. Matter of fact, the Bible calls them children, the analogous to a babe, 1 Peter 2:2, a babe in Christ. We understand a babe in Christ, if somebody just got saved, you expect them to be a babe in Christ. You expect that. And it's good that they desire the sincere milk of the word so they can grow. That's expected. But if you've been saved 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 40 years, you shouldn't be a babe in Christ anymore. You shouldn't be blown about by every wind of doctrine. Notice what he says. He continues here. He says, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. But verse 15 says, but speaking the truth in love may grow up. Here it is, grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. The Christian must grow in his spiritual life and not be full of knowledge. And this is the part I won't park on because I kind of already did, but I'll just say it one more time. That the Christian's not just full of knowledge, they're this sponge over here, and they're full in knowledge, but their disposition is not like is not Christ-like. That's not what God wants. He wants you to be able to give out something that you've learned for years. Okay? And it doesn't have to necessarily be in a Sunday school classroom or a junior church classroom or an adult class, an elementary class, a teen class. It doesn't have to, but I'll say this as a little caveat to that. It wouldn't hurt if you jumped in there and helped in those ministries as well. It wouldn't hurt. Matter of fact, that might be the S-T-A-R-T. A, the third point of my message today, acting in faith and getting out of your comfort zone and doing something that you don't normally do and doing it for the glory of God. Can I give you just a couple things tonight as far as hindrances, roadblocks that would stop you and me from growing spiritually? I'd say number one, a lack of effort. That's so profound. Well, you get out of it what you put into it. Christian growth is not automatic. It's not just this automatic, I'm just going to grow, I'm going to grow, I'm going to grow. Just, I'm a Christian, so I'm going to grow. You can still be a babe in Christ after 20 years of being saved. Let me give an example. 1 Corinthians chapter 3, you're there, you turned there. I think you turned there, 1 Corinthians 3. Look, if you would, at verse 1. Good example. Paul speaking to the church at Corinth here. Notice what he says in verse 1. He says, and I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but unto carnal. Why? Even as babes in Christ, I've fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto you are not able to bear it. Neither are you now able. Paul is rebuking the church at Corinth there, and he says, listen, you are so thin-skinned that I can blow smoke through you. You can't take it. I can't speak unto you into spiritual. I got to talk into your carnal. You're babes in Christ, and he lambastes them. Growth requires effort, but those who are spiritually lazy will simply follow the course of least resistance. Such will forever remain babes in Christ. And here's the irony of all of it. I've said it before, I'll say it again. God won't force himself on you. You can stay that way forever. Yeah, all the way. You could go to your grave not having one verse memorized because God isn't going to do it for you. It takes effort. And a lack of effort is one of the actual basic, simple things that many people don't understand when it comes to growing spiritually. Another hindrance is just simple discouragement. People get discouraged for a myriad of different reasons. But you know what? You know what's helped me? Because I even confessed this morning that I'm no different than you, and there's times I get discouraged. I've said it before, I'll say it again, that I've watched our church in the last 2 years, and it's just mind-boggling to me to go all the way back to the very first Sunday. Tom, you remember this, when we had the prophecy conference and the global warming, or no, it wasn't global warming, I don't remember, it was climate change. And we just getting the word. We'd heard the rumblings about COVID, and all of a sudden, you know, get the edicts that were coming down, and lockdowns were happening, and nobody really knew what to expect, and all of that, right? So that's almost two years ago. And then you come through the whole process and the political climate and the division in the country and all of this going on, and trying to be balanced and deal with all of that. And then we come in where you're outside, we're meeting outside, and then we're back inside, and there was a COVID thing, and we had to go back out, you know, or shut down for a while, and then we come back in, and the roof falls out, basically. Now we're meeting at a convention center. It was like a Holiday Inn on steroids. I mean, it was fine. I'm not complaining. Thank God for it. But there we were, and it was just very sterile, and it didn't feel like a church family, and half the ministries were shut down, and then we get back in here and all this stuff. So I say all that to say this. I have been discouraged, and I've had to go to the Lord and say, you know, your word says to know the state of the flock. I don't know where half the people are or what's going on, because nothing's normal right now. And so I've struggled. I've struggled with discouragement. I told my wife this afternoon, I said, whenever I start complaining a little bit, or I start, like, I don't understand this, the Lord says to me, let's see here. You pastor a local church. You have a church that loves you. Well, most of you do, I think. You have 5 acres. Everything is paid for. You have no debt. You have a great staff. No, I'm sorry, what? You were complaining about something? What was it? Yeah, because you want, oh, this guy over here who's bivocational and works 40 hours a week, and there's 20 people in his church, and he's just trying to make it. He's preparing all the messages while he's working 40 hours a week, plus has a family. I'm sorry, Jason, were you complaining about something? Because I could give you something to complain about. No, not at all. Thank you. I love you. And I'm just being transparent with you tonight. These are some struggles that I've had. And the Lord just rebukes me, and I just want to not say a word. And I'm going to show you something here that helped me put things in perspective, probably more than anything. If you think you got some troubles, I was talking to Pastor Fisher called me yesterday, and it's the first phone call in almost a year since his heart surgery, and then he had 2 strokes, and then he had seizures. He hasn't stood in the pulpit of his church for almost a year, and he hasn't preached, and he's just been going through it. He says, my arm just is like this. I lost my sight in my right eye. Walking is an issue. And he says, you know, it'll help you. He says, I go to the VA, because he served our country in some pretty, you know, he was like, did some pretty crazy stuff, because I won't even go into the details of stuff he told me in the Marine Corps that went on. But I'll tell you what, he said, when I go to the VA and I'm there for my appointment or my this or my surgery, and I look around at what's going on, he says, that'll put things in perspective. He says, there's a guy going wheeled down the hallway, going to his 7th surgery of this thing. He's going through it, and his disposition is good. He says, you know what? It'll put things in perspective. We don't have it as bad as we think we do. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, just if you'll just turn there, I want to show you what has helped me as well when it comes to discouragement. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, if you would, look at verse 24. Verse 24. Paul says this, and tell me if, look up here for 1 minute before we read, I'm going to say this. Okay, so if you're going through a hard time, read this and it'll help. Look at verse 24. Here's what Paul said. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Ouch! Thrice I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned. Thrice I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day have I been in the deep, in journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils of false brethren. Notice verse 27. In weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger, in thirst, in fasting often, in cold and in nakedness. So look, last thing. If that wasn't enough, look at verse 28. Besides those things, there are without, that are without, which cometh unto me daily, the care of all the churches. Plural. Lord, we had a, didn't have a very good offering today. Where the, you know, the attendance was low. A lot of people are out sick. What did you say here? And you just look at, okay. Tell me that wouldn't put things in perspective. You know what Paul said, though, and all of that? This was Paul's response to all that. Here's what he said. Well, we are troubled on every side, but we're not perplexed. We're cast down, but we're not forsaken, right? I mean, think about what his response was to all those things. Persecuted but not forsaken, cast down but not destroyed, perplexed but not in despair. Well, why didn't he get discouraged? Because Paul knew his labor was not in vain in the Lord. And I want to say to our church family tonight and those that are watching, how many of you are watching online tonight, don't ever get discouraged when it comes to serving God. And remember that your labor is not in vain. Be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you faint not. Another hindrance to spiritual growth is the law of disuse. Disuse, atrophy, if you will. A knife stays bright when used, but unused it becomes rusty. So it is with the Christian. We lose knowledge, ability, and opportunity when we could, when we do not use them. And I'm going to give you a little parenthetical within this here. As I say it again, the law of disuse. We lose knowledge and ability and opportunity when we do not use what God has given us. And here's the little caveat to that. And I say this to all of our folks here and folks online, and for us to guard against and be careful so don't misunderstand this. COVID has allowed many people, not everyone, but many that have chosen to use it as an excuse. They just have. They've used it as an excuse. And it's not the right thing to do. And sweetie, do you want to watch online tonight or do you want to go to church? Yeah, I've already said, and I was opposed to online for the whole time in the ministry. I know people love it. I don't like it. Amen. God bless you. And I want to say that with all due respect, I know what everybody that is either watching this later or watching it now, your response. So I'm going to qualify it. It does have its place, and it really has helped many people during this time. I understand that. But I will say this with all due respect. God did not intend for you or me to sit all day on a couch, not assembling together with people in a local church, encouraging one another so much the more as you see the day approaching. It has its place, But when it comes to serving God and worshiping together and assembling together, the law of disuse, whether you know it or not, whether I know it or not, will have an effect, an adverse effect, because it's the law of disuse. And there are people that have taken advantage of it. And they and it's not, you know, God knows your pernicious ways, and God will deal with you. If you sit all day and lay in bed for weeks, you lose muscle. Okay? Use it or lose it. You don't store up spirituality. To use another metaphor, unless we're earnest in our endeavor, we simply drift away from the Lord. I won't have you turn there, but the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 1, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things that we have learned, lest at any time we let them slip. And so you have to, you cultivate. I'll give you an example. I've been going and listening to some of Pastor Blue's messages. Samuel's been sending those to me, and I get a blessing because I'm trying to cultivate what I have learned, okay? Give the more earnest heed to the things that you have learned, lest at any time you let them slip. And guess what? There's nobody in here, including myself, that is above letting them slip. It just isn't. You have to guard against it. There's the law of indifference. You just have to be careful with that, all right? I'm going to give you the positives now when it comes to, when we talk about this litmus test, you're gauging where you are. And I'm going to close with these last couple thoughts, and this would be some advice for continuing your journey in serving God, even in the last days. Even in the last days. I would say, number one, become or remain active in the work of the congregation. Okay, begin immediately. Find something and do it for God. Get involved. Do something in your local church. It's important not to delay. Remember the hindrances, the law of disuse. I mean, if somebody has the gift of teaching and they don't use it, it's going to atrophy will set in. It's just, it's an irrefutable principle. There's a ministry for everybody, and the best time to start with something, is A, now, and B, something that you can handle. Even the most humble service can be a joy for those who are doing it to please God. Was it not David that said in Psalm 84 and verse 10, he said this, I would rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. Just, I don't care if somebody's an usher and they're simply just taking an offering or opening the door for somebody, or somebody's a hostess and they're just greeting somebody with a bulletin or a prayer journal or a prayer list and a smile. I'd rather do that than spend 1,000 days out there in the world. There's joy in it. And by the way, it helps you grow spiritually. You're doing something. We have all the excuses in the world as to why we don't. Not only that, if you haven't already, it's the beginning of the year, start a program of regular private devotions. Spend time each day alone with God, engaged in prayer, Bible study, and even singing praises. I'm not real big at doing this, but I've been doing it a little bit more lately, and I'm trying to sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs and make a melody unto the Lord in my own heart and sometimes out loud, much to the dismay of those in the office. Get in an adult class. During COVID, I used to go to Sunday school, but I got out of Sunday school. You know what I'm saying? Say something to our Sunday school teachers tonight. Even when you got mass people sick, we're coming out of the holidays, we've had snow, just hammered, and they're teaching, and they have smaller groups, there's less people coming, and all of this, and they just stay faithful, and they keep teaching. Instant, in season, out of season. God bless you for doing that. I appreciate it, and I know it's honoring to the Lord. Become involved in leading people to Christ. Andrew and Philip did. Lead somebody to Christ. People say many times, I can't do that. That's not my strength. I won't do it tonight. I'll probably do it next week because I'm planning on it already. So I'm working on some messages. But just remember the gospel's the power. Not how eloquent you are, not what you say, how you say it. It is the gospel. Even when you take a gospel track and you just simply hand it to somebody right there. That's the power. You say, well, I saw them. I turned around, I saw them, and they went like this, and they chucked it in the garbage. Yeah, you witnessed to them. And they're going home, and believe it or not, when they put their head on the pillow, like, oh, somebody tried to tell me about God, that religious stuff. And guess what's on their mind? God. God. Even a rejection is a witness. So don't lose sight of that. Don't lose sight of that. And then practice self-examination. Look internally. Have I helped someone to become a Christian? Am I enjoying life as a child of God? Am I becoming more like Christ? I think of Romans 8:29. People always quote Romans 8:28. But Romans 8:29 is so important. It says, whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of God, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Memorize scripture. Romans 10 is our challenge this year. Everybody in this church ought to memorize Romans 10. What I'm starting to do is I'm starting to write out the verse. And I'm going to start now because the older I get, the less I'm able to memorize verses. And so do that. Set a good example. And look internally. And if you want to bear fruit, then you do it by, one of the ways you do it is by being planted in the house of the Lord. The Bible says in Psalm 92, those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall bring forth fruit. And the way you get planted is you're just simply faithful. God is not interested in growing onions. He's interested in growing oaks, okay? And it takes time. And you just be faithful and honor God in doing so, okay? All right, we're going to stop there tonight. We're going to have a word of prayer. And you just kind of self-analyze as a litmus test is and see, am I engaged in these things? Are the hindrances blocking me from growing spiritually? So just kind of self-analyze, self-examine, and as I mentioned this morning, take inventory.